The atmosphere is a layer of gases surrounding our planet. Among these is water vapor, pure H2O that can be turned into drinking water. This sounds like good news for millions of people suffering from shortage of water due to lack of water sources or contamination of existing ones. But how can this be done? In order to present the technology that exists today and our model, we must first explain a few basic concepts in thermal physics. First is the concept of equilibrium pressure. This is the point at which a material's molecules have an equal probability to be in vapor or a condensed state. So if, for example, water vapor is at equilibrium pressure, it has an equal probability of staying in vapor state or condensing. This leads us to relative humidity, the pressure of water vapor relative to its equilibrium pressure. Now we understand that if the water vapor's pressure is equal to the equilibrium pressure, we will get condensation of water vapor. This is called the dew point. Notice that the humidity is a function of the temperature. Thus, given certain conditions, such as the amount of water in the air and the current temperature, we can calculate the dew point and the temperature change required to reach it. Another important concept is heat transfer. Heat can be transferred in three ways: convection, which is moving hot molecules from one place to another, conduction, the transfer of heat through a material, and radiation, light that carries heat, such as the sun's rays. Radiation heat transfer is an important part of our model. The sun's light is mainly in UV visible wavelengths, as opposed to radiation emitted by black bodies at Earth's surface temperature, which is mainly in the infrared. Since black bodies are a good approximation for any opaque object, we can calculate the emitted wavelength of certain materials as dependent of their temperature. An important material used in our model is glass. Since glass is transparent, it is obvious that it transfers visible light. But what's interesting is that glass does not transfer infrared. Therefore, if we want to heat a certain object using the sun's light and not allow it to cool down by emitting black body radiation, we can simply place it in a glass box. Now that we understand the main physical concepts, we can look at the previous designs that tackle the water harvesting problem. The main physical idea that we will try to produce works in the following manner. Take air filled with water and lower its temperature. This will take us to the dew point and condense the water. Sounds easy, right? Well, not so much. The amount of water in the air is pretty small, only about 25 grams per cubic meter. So the first thing we need is to fill some volume of air with tons of water. The second problem is cooling, taking air and maybe other materials and changing their temperature to reach the dew point. This can be a very costly process, and executing it efficiently could be hard. Now let's look at some existing designs. A well-known design is one from MIT. The machine is very simple. The layer of metal organic framework, MOF for short, performs as a desiccant and absorbs water from the air. This tries to overcome the problem of the low water density in the atmosphere. After absorbing the vapor, the MOF is exposed to sunlight, which causes the release of the vapor into the chamber. The lower surface, copper connected to a heat sink, a metal object used for enhanced conductivity, is cooled down by the surrounding, and thus allows condensation of vapor on its surface. Another concept we explored is using Peltier cooling, a thermoelectric cooling device, which uses the Peltier effect to create a heat flux between the junction of two different types of materials. Basically, it means that flowing current through the device creates a hot side and a cold side. These can be used to extract vapor absorbed in a desiccant on one side, and to reach dew point on the other. Unfortunately, common desiccants such as silica gel don't match the Peltier's heating capabilities. So how can we improve this design? Using our model. Our machine is composed of two models, the energy generation system and the water harvesting system. The water harvesting system is made of two compartments, a hot one and a cold one. These are divided by a piece of styrofoam with a little window on top to allow airflow between the compartments. The system is sealed from the environment using silicon rubber. Sun rays come through the glass covering the compartment and heat the bags of silica gel, a commonly found desiccant, used for water absorption. The IR radiation released from the silica and its surrounding is also kept inside the compartment by the glass. The wooden walls insulate against heat loss by conduction. At high enough temperatures, the vapor absorbed by the gel is released, and due to its relatively light weight, flows to the top of the system and into the cold compartment, where it condenses on the glass there due to the temperature difference between the rooms. This difference is maintained by using 1 millimeter thick glass on the cold compartment, which is a good conductor, while keeping the cold side unexposed to light. The condensed water slides across the glass on the cold compartment and is collected using water-resistant lining. Meanwhile, the energy unit charges a set of batteries, which will be used to heat the hot compartment at night using 2 resistors connected to heat sinks for better heat distribution. A full charge takes about 9 hours of sunlight. Each hour, the glass is removed and the silica gel is replaced with a new batch in order to enable adsorption outside the compartment. This allows continuous use of the machine during daytime. Now for some numbers.
Depending on its type, silica gel can absorb more than 10% of its weight in water vapor. We tested that for 100 grams of silica. After fully extracting the water vapor, it takes about 4 hours to absorb 10 grams of water. Thus, if we'll take 5 batches of 1 kilo of silica, we can operate our machine continuously, each time extracting vapor for 1 hour from 1 kilo of silica and leaving the other 4 batches to absorb for 4 hours. Note that these are typically low values, which usually absorbs 30% of its weight instead of 10. We think this might be due to damaging of our silica during testing. In the experiment, we produced 6 grams in an hour of sunlight and 10 grams in an hour using the heating pad. So, if we run our machine continuously during the daytime, assuming there are 12 hours of sunlight, we can produce 72 grams of water during the day. With our 16 amps per hour batteries, we can run the machine for 3 hours during nighttime and produce another 30 grams, thus extracting a total of about 100 grams of water a day. This operation can be more efficient. Our machine contains a big volume that is unused, keeping the same surface area exposed to sunlight while minimizing the volume could help heat the hot compartment faster. Adding focusing lens in front of the glass in order to accelerate the heating process could heat the compartment better during the day and extract water as efficiently as electricity-based extraction, thus making the machine more efficient.